was both a good thing and a bad thing, because you want to have some contrast and some vitality. So you have to kind of figure out, I need something large and something small. And so it was kind of a hunt to go from the digital, go back to the collection, see what we have, and go back and forth like that.
Very cool. I'm just going to change out this battery.
Okay. You need to be quiet.
Are you guys doing water or anything?
No, we're good.
You okay?
Come here, bud.
What's wrong? Probably about 10 more minutes. Okay.
All right.
Why don't you go back on your Osmo? Huh?
Okay.
Yeah, sounds great. True, we need to film, so please go back.
And then we'll be done, okay? We'll have fun.
Detach from mommy.
Yeah, we're almost done. Promise, Drew, we're almost done. Can you tell us a little bit about, can you talk a little bit about the actual presses you printed on? I know some of them you said you found, or some of them were...
The presses that we printed on are, we think, we don't really know, but we think they're proofing presses from the Star Newark Star Ledger. We've had them in Bradley Hall for over 25 years since I've been here.
And longer?
Yeah, they've probably been there longer. And what they are is, a proofing press is, you would throw a sheet or a galley of text on one of those presses, print it, someone would come along and proof it, you'd make the corrections, and then that portion would go on a bigger press. They're not really meant to be high-end volume. They're, like I said, they're very manually kind of based. They're Vandercook. We have two, Vandercook Universal 3 and a Universal.
I think they're both Universal 3.
Universal 3. One has an adjustable bed, which is great because not all the letter forms are, they're really weird. They come from all these different places. They're not exactly the same height, so you can adjust that, which is really nice. About 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when Express Newark was being developed, a kernel of the idea was to bring down the presses and make them available to the community. And we're doing that, trying to do that, not only through teaching them with Rutgers students, but slowly starting to kind of have outreach to community as well. It's a difficult process, it's a tedious process, so it's not as democratic or as easily or accessible as, say, silkscreen. But I think it's fair to say, like, letterpress enthusiasts, once you get bit by the letterpress bug, it's addictive. It's very physical, and they're great presses. Like, they are probably 60 plus years old, and still work perfectly.
Yeah, and about how many years ago we refurbished them? Probably about...
Right before they came down, so probably about 5 years ago?
Yeah. We spent a summer working with a technician and kind of learning how to take them apart and clean them properly and reassemble, and that was one of our fun summers. I could say we honestly know these presses like the back of our hands. They're very, you know, we've been on them for so long that they've become an extension of us. But they're amazing machines. Beautiful machines.
Yeah. Lucky to have them.
Mm-hmm. You spoke a little bit about this before, but how big was your team, and can you elaborate on the student collaboration a little bit more for this book creation?
Sure. So we worked with an amazing team of students through the summer on the printing process. And when we first kind of put the feelers out for those that may be interested in collaborating, we explained to them that this was a production job. You'd be learning the process of letterpress, everything from typesetting to color management to building forms to the printing itself. There were quite a few students that showed interest. We had, I think there was four from Pace University and probably about 20 from Rutgers. And so we got the whole team together. And the Rutgers students, because it is part of the curriculum, had, for the most part, had experience with it. for the students coming from Pace, this was a brand new experience for them. They really didn't know what to expect. They've heard me talk about it, but they didn't really know what it really entailed. So that first meeting, you know, we were really honest with them about what this was about and the time commitment, the labor commitment, you know, what it really took. And we thought for sure at least half would bail and not want any interest. So we set a schedule up and shockingly all of them stuck with it. And it actually got to the point where they were wanting to volunteer even more time, that they were kind of getting hooked on this process, that we actually had to ask at one point for students to kind of cut back some of their commitments because we had more hands than we could use in the process. And that kind of reaffirmed for us kind of the addictive nature of the process, because we thought it was just us. but the students really fell in love with it as well.
There was an interesting point where certain students, not all of them for various reasons, but there were certain students that kind of took on extra responsibility. And not that, I mean, because it is a labor of love and it is our second child, we were around, hovering around most of the times, probably hawkishly hovering around. But there were times when a student would recognize an issue or a problem and kind of solve it, which I wasn't anticipating. I thought it would be that they would need a lot of hand-holding. But there were multiple points where, again, like students saw an issue, resolved it, and then let me know what they did or let Brenda know what they did. And that was kind of gratifying because there are many little problems to be solved in this process because it's kind of organic and it's not command P, right? There's so many things to it. And, you know, the question that we get all the time is, well, why? Okay, you can just print it on the computer. Why do this? And I think partly it's the tactile and the smell and the artifact that you create, but it's also, I think, the kind of community that you build with the students. Like this body of students are always going to be special to us. We're always going to have a connection to them. We've become more than just student teacher.
Yeah, and even cross university, like the bond between, you forget which ones are the Pace students, which ones are the Rutgers students, because they've all become such good friends at this point from being through this experience. That's really, really cool to see, because that's the beginning of their creative network, right? When they graduate and they go on, they've had these connections and they have this bond and they can look out for each other and kind of help each other out. And for us, I mean, it was amazing. I mean, to see the transformation. It was no, like, the summer started with that kind of typical hierarchy of, you know, the teachers and the students, but very quickly into it, it switched to just true collaborators, you know, and we were all kind of working together for this one, you know, massive goal. I'm just thrilled that they fell in love with the process. And it's also really gratifying to teach those skills to students and know that this process is going to live on and that they're going to want to do this again and conceive their own projects and work in this manner. That's, I think, the most gratifying part for us, is knowing that they now have that ability to kind of take lead and move forward with this.
So. And we're kind of making it up to be like it was a perfect summer. It wasn't.
Oh, no.
It was stress-filled.
God, no.
What did Jeff say the other night? The most... say something like the worst fun you ever had, something like
true.
This.
There's a lot of truth. I mean,
yeah,
you could
intense.
Not have had a more stressful summer, but it was so satisfying in the end, you know, and it was worth, well, yeah, it was worth,
yeah,
beginning to relive some of the trauma, but it was worth the, you know, in the end, it's definitely worth that experience. It was not all fun. But that's also what made it so special, is that those students saw how hard this work was and what it really took to pull this off, and they didn't shy away. If anything, that got
surprising.
Them more engaged. Like, they were determined, like, we were not gonna not do this, you know? And that was pretty, pretty special, though.
excuse me. You guys answered a lot of questions. That was really good. I'm just thinking of questions in my head, but I'm gonna ask what's here. What is the next steps for the ABC book?
The next steps for the ABC's book is really now the promotion of the book. You know, now that we've kind of gone through the most daunting part was the actual production. We're still immersed in that. We have the collating, the folding, the binding, the you know, we kind of kept adding little nuances to it. There's embossing on the covers. So there's a lot of detail that still needs to happen. And we are kind of working through that and chipping away at it. But yeah, it's also
an edition of 350. Yeah. We have about 363 books that can be made, but we'll make an edition of 350. And so we're about a quarter of the way through